My name's Dr. Paul Jackson from Plant Integrity, and I'm going to talk today about the guided wave activity at TWI. The outline to the presentation is as follows. I'm going to start by giving a background to what TWI is, and then I'm going to talk about the guided waves and its applications on pipelines. I'm going to continue this with a few case studies and talk about where the technology on pipelines is going in the future. Then I'm also going to talk about future developments of using guided waves on different applications. And finally, there'll be some contact details at the end. So, what is TWI? TWI is a membership-based organisation with industrial members all over the world. It's a non-profit distributing company, which although makes profits, it doesn't distribute these to companies. It reinvests it into technology. It's a research and technology organisation. It also provides training and examination services and certification through the CSWIP scheme and others. And finally, it has a professional institute with over 6,000 professional members, and you can get qualifications such as your chartered engineer status through this institute. Plant Integrity is a subsidiary company of TWI, and it provides teletest services and equipment. Teletest is known as long-range ultrasonic testing, or is also known as guided wave ultrasonic testing. It is a wholly owned subsidiary of TWI. The technology was developed in the 1990s, particularly for the problem of corrosion under insulation, but it is widely used now where areas are inaccessible. And in these areas, the cost of access can exceed the cost of inspection. And 70% of plant inspection costs relate to pipework. What guided waves offers is a rapid screening for in-service degradation. It reduces the costs of gaining access, avoids the removal, reinstatement of insulation that is only required where at the location of the transducer tool. It also provides the ability to inspect inaccessible areas. And the key to the technology is you're providing 100% coverage using guided waves. So this is illustrated in this slide here. As you can see, in a pipeline, if you're using conventional ultrasonics, in order to find the areas of metal loss, the transducer tool itself would have to be over the particular area of metal loss. However, when you use guided waves, you transmit and receive the signal along the pipe, and where there's a change in cross-sectional area, you get a change in acoustic impedance, which causes a reflection back to the tool. Obviously, welds are going to be at known distances from the tool, and from these you can work out where the location of metal loss is. So in terms of detection, you could detect both internal or external metal loss. The technique doesn't distinguish between the two. Sensitivity, we can detect metal loss down to 3% cross-sectional area of the wall, or reliable detection is 9% metal loss. This is equivalent to about 5% amplitude reflection. There's a trade-off between sensitivity and the distance you can transmit and receive along the pipeline. If you want something that's more sensitive, then this will reduce your diagnostic length. We could discriminate between flaws and pipe features such as welds, bends, and pipe supports. And there's a longitudinal accuracy of plus or minus 100 millimetres. The limitations to the technique is a large volume of material is examined from a single point, and this does limit your sensitivity and resolution. Pipe conditions, particularly coatings, can influence the test performance. Currently, there's no means of providing flaw sizing from guided waves, which means that a follow-up technique or more quantitative technique is used to determine fitness for service data. So it is still a screening technique. This slide illustrates the performance of guided waves on different conditions. So if you take into consideration the surface condition, if it's a bare metal pipe, then that will propagate very well. But as you degrade the surface of the pipe, either through pitting or through providing coatings, then that does tend to reduce the distance you can achieve. So for example, you know, if you're moving into a buried bitumen or concrete coated pipe, then you may find that that is unsuitable for guided waves. Similarly, the more complex the geometry, again, that will reduce the distance you could achieve to the point where a flange would be the end of test because there's no continuous metal path between the two flange sections. And finally, the more viscous the contents, the lower the distance that you can achieve using guided waves. Typically, on above ground pipelines, we would estimate on plus or minus 30 metres in both directions. On above ground pipelines in ideal conditions, which are bare metal, straight lengths and gas contents, we have achieved 180 metres in both directions. However, as I mentioned previously, on bitumen and concrete coated pipelines, you may find that the attenuation is too high for the technique. So the features of the equipment, we could inspect anything from 1.5 inch to 48 inch diameter pipeline. We have recently expanded this up and the maximum size we've inspected is 62 inch. It has 100% coverage, as I mentioned previously. Typically we'd be estimating plus or minus 30 meters on above ground pipeline. Ideal conditions, we have achieved 180 meters in both directions. In terms of productivity, the data collection itself takes minutes. However, with permetry and travel to different locations, we would estimate on 10 locations per day. Under ideal conditions, 3 kilometres of pipeline has been inspected in a 12-hour day. Maximum service temperature of the equipment at the moment is 120 degrees. This slide illustrates how the interpreter or the operator will interpret the data. Basically, the welds are circumferential and give a very typical response, which can be illustrated in this graph. And these welds are used to calibrate. What you're looking for are features that come out of the noise and they can be measured with relative to the welds. So there's a cold DAC line and there's a maximum usable sensitivity line. And where these two meet, that is your limit of diagnostic range or your diagnostic length. What we're looking for is changes in cross-sectional area. And as I mentioned previously, typically this is the minimum sensitivity is between 3 and 9% cross-sectional area. So the applications where the technique is readily used is road and river crossings. The technique and teletest is compliant with the PHMSA regulations in North America. Power plant tubing, risers, particularly looking at splash zones, offshore topside pikeworks, deck penetrations, etc. It's used very readily on jetty lines because usually those are insulated pipelines. Again, refinery pipework due to its having insulation. Chemical plants, tank floams, we've done work on sphere legs, pipe bridges, and spirally welded pipe we find we can inspect. Typically, the greater the pipe diameter, the less the spiral weld has an effect on the data collected. We can also inspect stainless steel lines. We don't suffer from the grain boundary scatter that conventional UT suffers from. And finally, we've done some work on boiler spines. So anywhere where there's pipelines that requires inspection and, you know, is likely to be inaccessible. Teletest was the first commercial product on the market. It was first sold in 1999, and this slide illustrates some of the very early prototype tools that were developed at TWI. Now we're on our fourth generation, which we call Teletest Focus Plus, and basically the unit and tooling has all been designed to speed up collection and improve the quality of the data. We use multimode, which is both longitudinal and torsional wave modes, mounted on the same tool. There are pros and cons to both wave modes, but when you inspect a pipeline for the first time, we would always recommend that you use multimode because it's not always clear which wave mode will propagate the best on a pipeline. The Teletest Focus also provides focusing. We do this in two ways. We can either transmit and receive the signal with time delays on the collar, so we're doing a secondary test, or we can do a C-scan image where we interpret the received data and look at the areas around the tool where we receive the signal. And finally, we've got a very user-friendly interface with reporting because the operator needs to be able to do that in a very efficient way for the end user. So these are the wave modes in the pipeline. The longitudinal is more similar to a compression wave, and the torsional has more of a twisting motion. So we transmit and receive either of these two symmetric modes, and where there's a local feature or defect, what this will do is convert into a flexural mode. And from these flexural modes, this is where you're likely to be using the data as corrosion and finding corrosion. The Teletest Focus has an integrated battery, is easily capable of 12 hours site operation on one charge, and should you be operating on a 24-hour shift, the battery is easily exchanged for another one. It's got an integrated air pump so that you can inflate the collar from the unit. We monitor that using the software so we can ensure that the data quality is very good. We have basic LEDs communication, and it comes in a ruggedized carry case. The collar design, we're using high-tech carbon fiber composite collar construction. This is to ensure that the collar is lightweight and provides an effective coupling surface for the transducers. Integrated within this collar clamps and the bladder. The collar is the only component within the system that is pipe specific. The modules themselves can be moved quickly into different collar sizes, such that if you are inspecting different pipe sizes, it's quite quick to interchange the modules. Also, the collars link for pipe sizes greater than 24 up to 48 inch. And as I mentioned previously, we've recently extended this, and the maximum size we've done is 66 inch with special procedures. As I mentioned also, the technique we're using is multimode. So it's all very lightweight and cost efficient. This slide illustrates the daisy linking process. The photo at the bottom was an inspection on a 36 inch pipe out in Mexico. For smaller pipe diameters, up to 6 inch, we have a mini test system. At these sort of sizes, the pipes can be racked much closer together. So again, this is a modular system, but it's single mode, so you can either choose longitudinal or torsional, but usually for 4 inch and below, the longitudinal wave mode becomes dispersive and therefore is unsuitable. So usually the torsional wave mode is the one that's used to do the inspection. Again, it's lightweight design and modular. As much of the software as possible is automated. So once the operator puts in the pipe size and the wall thickness, the software itself will generate all of the dispersion curves and the recommended frequencies for inspection. Also on inspection, provide the best fit for the weld calibration, so it will pick out the welds automatically and set the curves. As I mentioned previously, data collection takes a matter of less than 5 minutes. When you need to do the focusing process, you can do that very efficiently with one click. And all of the data that you input into the software will then be transferred into the Microsoft Word report. We've recently released a torsional only module. Now this is a 5-ring torsional, but it operates at 3 rings at 2 different spacing. So the third ring provides 66% greater sound energy into the pipe, which can be very useful when it comes to the high attenuation lines. So the two transducer spacings that we use within this module are 30mm and 45mm. We would always recommend utilising the multimode technology. However, in certain applications, this may be unsuitable. For example, if it's liquid-filled or thick-walled pipe. And therefore, this torsional module is a suitable tool, or a complementary tool rather, to provide the best inspection. And what the two ring spacings provide is it allows the operator to inspect between 20 and 100 kilohertz without having to change the spacing of the transducers. So it gives them a much broader range of frequencies that the technology can use. The Teletest system has focusing capability, and what focusing does is it allows the energy to be concentrated where the defect is, increasing sensitivity and giving a position and more size and information. So the sound energy is concentrated in one region of the pipe, This is then rotated 8 times around the pipe. It has the potential of 4 times greater sensitivity. However, obviously you are doing the initial screening first and then you're using the focusing as a complementary technique and a secondary technique in order to give the operator more confidence about there being a defect in that particular location. So, for example, in this case, the amplitudes of the responses from the two defects in the photos are actually low amplitude. However, when you focus in these particular locations, you could see that the amplitude of the signals within the focus plots are all in one octant. And therefore, this gives the operator confidence that although it might be low amplitude, the signal response, it's very much in one location, therefore he should give that a call. So we tend to report anomalies not only in terms of amplitude, but also in terms of directionality, which we can do from the focusing data either through this secondary technique or through the C-scan image. In terms of the report manager generator, this is to increase the report or the speed of report. So it's very user-friendly, and what you do is you build up trees. So you could add a chapter. So a chapter could be a pipe, and then within that chapter you have location 1, 2, 3, 4. So you could have chapter 1 being a 10-inch pipe, location 1, 2, 3, 4, chapter 2 being a 6-inch pipe, location 1, 2, 3, 4. And it's encouraged that they build this up as they do the inspection. So then at the end of the inspection, the reporting becomes much easier. The training provided by TWI is through the CSWIP independently certified scheme. There's level 1, 2 and 3 training courses, and it's all compliant with ISO 9712 and also meets the requirements of EN473. So typical applications where the technology is used, and a few case studies now. So the first case study is for jetty lines. This is an ideal application for guided waves because usually the pipeline's inaccessible without scaffolding, it's insulated, the salt water environment is corrosive, and it's usually, relatively speaking, short lengths, which are non-piggable due to close proximity of bends, etc. And what guided waves allows you to do is to be able to provide 100% inspection between the scaffolding. So we've got an area here where the operator's put the tool on the pipeline and he's inspected in the forward and backwards direction. He's got a suspected area of corrosion. When he measures it out, it is actually on a seam of the casing of the insulation. So it is a high risk area. And you can see here in the results, there's clearly a peak at 5 meters in the backwards going direction. And you can see that it's even affected the weld signal further down the line. And when that area was exposed, they found a 1 meter length of corrosion with about 35% wall loss. There are many examples that we have of where the technology has been used to find corrosion. So this is another corrosion under insulation. You can see here this pipe's got steam heat tracing on as well, as is this one. Again, this one's got more corrosion under insulation. 4 millimeter wall loss on this example. And again, this one's got 3 millimeter wall loss. One of the areas that have really embraced the technology of guided waves is road crossings. And Plant Integrity have been using guided waves for road crossings since 1998. And we've got a lot of information on in terms of the follow-up data since about 2003. So we've experienced road crossings up to 75 meters wide. Usually they're cased, and the diameters varies between 3 and 30 inch, and they contain a variety of products and combinations of products, and insulated with polyurethane foam. Within the particular application we've been working on, corrosion at field-applied weld packs has been a known problem, and teletest and guided waves is carried out to the FEMSA 18-point checklist. The guided wave data is then input into the end user's information, and you know the end user will excavate a number of lines annually for a variety of reasons, not just guided wave data but other factors including regulatory reasons, replacement programs, risk rankings. But all of this data has been fed back to us from the clients. And, you know, to date, we've over sort of 600 road crossings tested, 100 have been excavated, and using guided waves, 117 have been confirmed by NDT. So it shows you the value of guided waves when used in the right application. This is a particular sort of example of field-applied weld-pack corrosion. So this corrosion usually occurs near the weld. The technology can also be used to evaluate and find corrosion at welds. In this particular case, the longitudinal wave mode was more suitable than torsional. And because you've got this C-scan imaging and also the focusing, usually welds will give you a very evenly distributed response because obviously the weld should be welded equally around the circumference. However, when this distribution is not correct or not as it should be, then this is illustrated quite readily in the C-scan imaging. And you can see here you've got a high flexural response in the signal and you've also got a high flexural response in the C-scan imaging. And when this was exposed, they found corrosion at the weld. Buried lines is an interesting application for guided waves because obviously the technique lends itself to be able to inspect in the forward and backwards direction in this type of application because you only need to expose the pipe in one location. However, the soils and different soils around the world can have different effects on the attenuation. So in this particular example, we were able to achieve plus or minus 30 meters from this location. However, on very clay, wet soils, we have had instances where we've not been able to achieve any sort of range using teletest and guided waves because the soil is highly attenuative. Also, in this particular application, the pipe was actually FBE coated, and this seems to form a barrier between the pipe and the soil, allowing the guided waves to propagate much further than expected. So in buried lines, we would be very keen to share the risk, or we would be very keen for people to try the technology, but be aware that it may not be suitable for that particular application. This is something that we've developed recently, and this is the inspection of fin tube. And this also illustrates the difference in how the different wave modes propagate along the pipeline. This particular application, you've got steel fins welded to the external surface of the pipe, and these are all along the length. And then these are used in furnaces. And when we use the torsional wave mode, you could see that because of the twisting motion, it would not propagate because of the fins. However, when you use longitudinal wave mode, you can clearly see the weld and the pipe end and the defect along the tube. So this is something that we're now developing a tool to provide in-service inspection. The drivers for guided waves in the future is very much going towards permanent installation and permanent monitoring. We've developed a permamount tool, which has all the benefits of teletest focus, it's low profile, but because you can compare to previous data, be able to find much smaller defects within the pipeline. It's easy to install, but the key is the tool must remain stable over long periods of time. But because you can compare the data, you're taking quite a bit of the variability of the inspection out. So it does allow you to be able to find much smaller defects and much smaller changes. At the moment, this is readily used where the cost of exposing the pipe in order to put the tool on exceeds the inspection. Then in that case, it's much more cost effective to put a permanent installation on the pipe so that in future, you don't need to expose the pipe. All you need to do is take the unit up to the connector, connect it up, and you'll be able to inspect it in situ. This is our next generation of tool and its encapsulation, and this is a recent installation that we did in Canada, and you can see we're below the water table here and it's quite an aggressive environment. As I mentioned previously, it allows you to compare tests between the data, and one of the advantages of the permamount tool is we get much higher output of signal, which is certainly good in terms of being able to look for small variations and changes in the data. We've also developed an internal tool. This was specific for drill riser inspection. At the moment, a random thickness checks are carried out and MPI. But what guided waves can offer is the ability to inspect the whole length from two locations. And you could also inspect the outer pipelines using our mini test kit. So we're hoping that this would be a much quicker and cost-effective way of inspecting, hopefully in situ while the risers are still on the barge. In the future of where guided waves is going, TWI has a research and development group consisting of about 10 people looking at diversifying guided waves into different applications. And the group itself has won quite a lot of funding from the TSB or the European Union. The group itself, we've got over $7 million worth of research projects in guided waves. If you incorporate plant integrity, there's over 38 people involved in guided wave activity at TWI. And this is funded through a variety of funding streams, such as TWI's internal research and development budget, industrial members, ITF, and collaborative projects either funded through the EU or even the UK government. And there's currently 14 guided wave projects operating within the group. And I'm going to summarise some of these now. The guided wave technique can be summarised into three specific areas. You've got the software, the hardware, and the tooling. So within the software, you've got technique development. Within the hardware, you've got electronics development. And obviously, you've got tooling and array design. And within TWI, we work on the technology readiness level, one being the basic idea and nine being the sort of proven through and successfully applied in the industry. So we use it a variety of software and technique developments. We've developed a automated research software for data collection, and this allows the user to basically individually control all of the transmit and receive channels within the teletest. And we're looking at sizing of defects on pipelines. We're looking at broadband frequency analysis, condition monitoring techniques, tomography, time series analysis, and full matrix capture. All of these are sort of very common research topics within NDT generally, and we're applying these techniques to guided waves. Within the hardware, we're using the latest Teletest Focus Plus as the platform for everything that we do in the future, but at the moment the Teletest is designed very much with pipeline inspection in mind. So it's got 24 transmit channels, 24 receive channels, so it's a very quick device for inspection of pipelines. However, in the future, in terms of monitoring, you may not need all of the 24 channels. You might want more, you might want less. So we're looking at simplified Teletest units. We're also looking at multiplexing. And once you've got these in place, then you need to be able to do wireless connectivity, energy harvesting, and looking at the power consumption. We're also looking at marinization and broadening the frequency range that we use for the inspection. In terms of tooling, we've developed a permanently installed tool for pipelines. We're looking at encapsulation of transducers for plates, high temperature transducers. We're testing prototype transducers at 250 degrees C, and we have ideas for transducers up to 450 degrees C. Marinization, this is on a three-pronged approach. You know, you've got permanently installed, diver deployable, and ROV deployable. And finally, we're looking at array designs for tanks, plates, chains, and rails. So the first project I'm going to talk about is HotScan. Plant Integrity are in collaboration here with Brunel University, and it's basically to develop a long-range ultrasonic system for continuous in-service inspection at high temperature. So we're looking within the power generation industry for this type of application. Ideally, we'd be able to detect cracks, particularly at the welds. So we've had to develop high-temperature transducers, and we now have transducers that are capable of about 250 to 300 degrees. We've also tested transducers up to 450 degrees C. And we've also developed a high temperature color array. This is particularly for continuous monitoring. Another project that we've been looking at has been tank integrity monitoring, which is applying guided waves for the monitoring of the tank floors within ground storage tanks. This was in collaboration with end users of Vopak, Newstar and Shell, and also was funded by the UK government. What we're trying to do within this project is determine the performance of the use of guided waves up to a 30 metre diameter tank, develop a prototype system, and verify the performance of the actual tank floor. So we built a 4 metre tank at CWI, and we put transducers equally spaced around the circumference. We used the teletest system with the multiplexer so that we could transmit and receive on as many transducers as we could, and all of this was computer controlled. So these are some of the tomography examples at 45 kilohertz, showing the stability of the system that we've created. And then we added a defect into the tank floor. Comparing the data collected to a baseline data and using data analysis techniques, we were able to detect changes in signal when the defect was about 15 millimeters. We then looked at applying tomography techniques, and we were able to detect the image of the defect using tomography at about 50 millimeters. And as you add more and more defects in the tank, we were able to improve our imaging. So you can see here, within this tank, there's three defects, 70mm, 70mm and 20mm. And you can see that all of them are readily visible on the tomography image that we have here. We're now in the process of launching a group-sponsored project in this, and there is another webinar particularly regarding this subject, which is readily available. So if you need further information, then please contact us and we'll get you in touch with the relevant people for this project. We've also looked at in situ monitoring of wind turbine towers. We trialled the system on a 48-inch pipe here at TWI. Within this, we were using simple baseline subtraction, and you could see how when a notch is put into the pipe, using this simple technique, you're able to clearly see where that notch has been put in. And all of this information can, or all of these techniques, can be applied to pipelines. What we've also did within this project was we put a basic system and installed it into a wind turbine in Glasgow, and we can wirelessly remotely link to the unit and collect the data from our office here in Cambridge. The next project that I'm going to present here is a project called CellScan, which was a European Union funded project. And within guided waves, what we're trying to do usually is we're trying to control the wave mode. So the reason why we have a lot of sensors around a pipe is because we're trying to restrict and control what wave mode we transmit, in what direction, and what wave mode we receive. Within the CellScan project, we're turning the concept on its head. So we're looking at simplified transducers, arrangements, transmitted and receiving, and can we detect changes? What we've got in this particular example is a sort of wishbone structure, and a transducer can transmit and receive through this irregular object. We are going to receive complex signals, but by analysing the historical data, can we identify growing defects? So this structure you can see in this picture below was fatigue tested. So there was a notch put into the sample, and this was grown using the fatigue testing rig shown in the picture. And we collected ultrasonic data at regular intervals. So a 1 millimeter notch was introduced to initiate a fatigue crack, and then this crack was grown from 0 to 5 millimetres in surface length. If you actually look at the data itself, there's not much difference between the data. However, when you start to look at this on a time-dependence plot, you can see how the plot changes with time. And if you sort of compare what's termed the number of outliers, you can see this grow as the fatigue crack grows. And then if you plot a graph of the data collection number with the number of outliers, you can see here at round about 14 data collections, there's a discernible difference between the initial data and the data collected after 14. The area in red is when the dye penetrant detected the crack. So using the guided wave technique, you could argue we were able to detect the cracks before dye penetrant. And this is something that's very interesting to TWI, and we're going to pursue further through TWI's core research funding. Subsea Test is a project that is looking at inspection of subsea structures using guided waves. And we were able to develop a system that we did actually mount onto an ROV. And we've been able to look at various technology readiness levels for each aspect of the components. And we're looking at further funding to take this on to the next stage. So there's different technology readiness levels for diver deployable and ROV deployable systems. The final project I want to talk about is using guided waves to inspect wiring. So we're looking here at defects within aircraft wiring. And one of the things we were able to do was to detect defects using guided waves. So within these four scans, you can see here we've got an insulation split. Underneath, we've got the abrasion. In the top right-hand corner, we've actually got insulation removed. And what this shows was that the guided waves propagated as a system within the, not only within the core wire, but also within the coating itself. Obviously, detecting areas of coating breakdown is quite difficult to do in situ, especially if the wiring is inaccessible. So again, this is a project that we're taking forward through a European funded project, which is about to start. So we were able to achieve good guided wave performance in long wires. We were very sensitive to various defects on different types of wires, and we developed software to display the guided wave data. So that's a summary of the guided wave activity at TWI. If you would like further information, then please do not hesitate to contact me on any of the telephones, emails, or websites given below. Thank you very much for your attention.